All right, let's go ahead and get started. Welcome, Analysis 1B. It is October 3rd. Happy Mean Girls Day. We are doing this video in pink. In this lesson, we are going to look at our third integration technique, getting tricky with it. In all seriousness, the chapter name, the type of integration technique that we're going to do today is trig subs. All right, this is chapter 8.4. 8.1 was just review of some trig techniques. 8.2 was integration by parts. 8.3 was oig trig integrals. And then this is trig sub integrals. We're going to use a very fancy U sub that involves trig. I have two prerequisites that I want to address before we get into it. The first of which is let's review the Pythagorean identities. All right, the trig Pythagorean identities. I also want to look at the integral of secant. And then just what is it and why is it that? All right, these two things will be useful in the rest of this lesson. All right, this integral will do a good job explaining why we would want to substitute trig expressions into integrals that don't have trig in them at all. Let's look at some of the integrals that we're going to do today. We're going to do three examples. Example number one is going to be the integral of the square root of x squared minus 9 all over x dx. Example number two, we are going to look at the integral of 1 over x times the square root of 25x squared plus 16 dx. And then example number three, hopefully I have enough room here on the right side of the screen, the integral of x squared over the square root of negative x squared minus 2x plus 5. All right, so if you want to try to attempt any of these integrals before we get started with the knowledge that trig is going to be our u sub, right? We have x squared minus 9, we have 25x squared plus 16, we have this trinomial that maybe can be factored. All right, if you want to try to attempt any of these integrals before we get started, go right ahead and see if you can come up with why this trig substitution into these integrals will work. But these are the three integrals that we are going to tackle in this video. We are going to use the Pythagorean identities to do so. So let's go ahead and get started and talk about these Pythagorean identities. One last thing before we get started. I am coming back from the end of this video because I had a copy error in this last one. I want this to be a 3. So I'm fixing this. As you proceed through the video, I may come back to this page to reference it. You're going to see this is a 5, but when we do this problem late in the video, it will be a 3 because of my copy error. All right, let's move on to the Pythagorean identities. So, prereq. Number one, the Pythagorean identities. So there's many ways to re-derive these or to think about them. We're going to do the most simple and most reliable, I think, way to remember the Pythagorean identities in this video. But I'll throw up a picture right here that geometrically kind of proves the three Pythagorean identities. All right. But real quick, here's the Pythagorean identities. Let me give myself a unit circle. All right, on the unit circle, given an angle theta, this coordinate is cosine x, comma sine x. Cosine theta minus sine theta. This gives me my dimensions of my right triangle. And then we can see that sine squared theta plus cosine squared theta equals 1 using the Pythagorean theorem. Now, taking this, I can divide each expression in this equation by sine squared. Divide sine squared by sine squared. I'm going to get 1 cosine squared divided by sine squared. That's cotangent squared. And then 1 divided by sine squared. That is cosecant squared. Cool. I now have two Pythagorean identities. And then I can divide the first equation. I could probably divide the second equation by something. But I can divide the first equation by cosine squared. And I can get sine squared divided by cosine squared. That's tangent squared. Cosine squared divided by cosine squared. That's 1. 1 divided by cosine squared. That is secant squared theta. Awesome. I have my three Pythagorean identities. Now, before I proceed to my next prereq for the day, I wanted to get these down. I want to rearrange these three formulas, Formula 1, Formula 2, and Formula 3, in a very specific way, and you'll see why in a second. In a couple minutes. But I want to rearrange these in the following way. I'm going to rewrite the first Pythagorean identity as follows. Cosine squared is equal to 1 minus sine squared theta. And I want to rewrite the last one in two different ways. I want to write secant squared theta is equal to 1 plus tangent squared theta. And tangent squared theta is equal to secant squared theta minus 1. And I wrote these in a very specific way. This is going to be what we use to do our trig substitution, right? Because this first one is 1 minus something squared. The second one is 1 plus something squared. And the third one is something squared minus 1. I have 1 minus something squared, 1 plus something squared minus 1. Let me go back to those three integrals. And I want you to continue to think about how you might be able to solve these without any help. We have x squared minus 9. We have 25x squared plus 16. We have, this one's a little bit tricky, but we have this polynomial that maybe can be factored. Now let's specifically look at these first two. I have something squared minus 9. I have something squared plus 16. Fast forward. I have 1 minus something squared. I have a number minus something squared. I have a number plus something squared. I have something squared minus a number. Right? This is going to be what allows us to use trig. It's a very clever U substitution, which is best exemplified by doing some examples, which we'll get to very soon. To do these trig problems, all you really need to know are these three identities. So commit these to memory. I mean, you already knew them. You already had them, hopefully, committed to memory. But these, cosine squared is equal to 1 minus sine, secant, 1 plus tan, secant minus 1, these are the ones that you are going to need to know like that. Moving on to my second prereq. Let's just real quick remind ourselves what the integral of secant x is. All right, we've done secant cubed before in class. Well, we did cosecant cubed in class. So you should know what the integral of secant x is, but let's justify it. All right, you do need to have this integral memorized. But let's prove what it is first so that memorizing it is significantly easier. This will also kind of motivate why we often use trig to integrate things that don't have trig in them, right? Because trigs have interesting derivatives. They have interesting integrals, and we can usually use that to our advantage. We'll see why. All right, so what we do to get the antiderivative of secant x is we are going to multiply by a very fancy version of 1. Right. What is that fancy version of 1? Well, I'm going to ultimately want to take some sort of u substitution here. So I'm going to multiply by secant x plus tangent x over secant x plus tangent x. Right. We are going to get some stuff that looks like the derivative of tangent and secant once we simplify this a little bit. All right, if I keep going. I'm going to get secant squared x plus tan x secant x. Let me actually rewrite that, where secant is first. Secant x tan x all over secant x plus tan x dx. We are very close to the end of this integral, because if we go and we set u equal to, if we set u equal to secant x plus tan x, then what's du going to be? What's the derivative of secant x? What's the derivative of tan x? This is kind of the essence of what we're going to do today, right? If you've forgotten, you can always just rewrite these as sines and cosines and use chain rule and the product rule or the quotient rule, right? But secant x ends up being secant x tan x, and tan ends up being secant squared x. Oh my gosh, that is our numerator. Secant squared x plus secant tan x dx. So we are home free, right? We're going to have, we're going to replace this numerator with du, and we're going to replace the denominator with u. And then we're going to get ln absolute value, don't forget the c, of our u, secant x plus tan x, right? You need to know this. And you also need to know the antiderivative of cosecant x, right? But it's the natural log of the absolute value of secant x plus tan x. Right, those are our two prereqs, the Pythagorean identities rewritten in a very specific way, and also the antiderivative of secant, because we're going to be turning our three integrals here. Where are they? There they are. We're going to be turning our three integrals into trig integrals, which is going to result in having to utilize this second prereq. Right, we're going to have to take the integral of secant or cosecant or something like that. Sine, cosine, those ones are easy. So let's have this one in the pocket. All right, let's get to the meat of the lesson. All right, the new integration technique. My first example was the integral of the square root of x squared minus 9 all over x with respect to x. Let me rewrite those three very useful forms of the Pythagorean identities. We had cosine squared theta is equal to 1 minus sine squared theta. We had secant squared theta is equal to 1 plus tangent squared theta. And moving the second one around, we have tangent squared theta is equal to secant squared theta minus 1. Right? These are the three forms that we care about. Take a moment to think about how you can use these trig equations to simplify this expression. Right? What is complicated about this expression? Right? In my opinion, it's that square root. I want to get rid of that square root. How can I get rid of that square root? Well, over here, I have a tangent squared. Maybe if I could turn this x squared minus 9 into some tangent squared. Oh, wait, look. Secant squared minus 1, that kind of looks like this. Right? Maybe if I can write x squared minus 9 as secant squared minus 1 or something similar, I can then replace the secant squared minus 1 or the secant, whatever it ends up being, with a tangent squared. Right? I can't just, you know, throw it in there and call it a day. There's a lot of little steps that go along with this. But if I can turn x squared minus 9 into tangent squared theta, then I can get rid of the square root. I just have a tangent theta. Right? That's the whole idea with these. So we're going to be trying to get rid of this square root. So how can I do that? Well, let's just try something. Let's replace x squared with not secant squared theta, but 9 secant squared theta. All right, think about that. Replacing x squared with 9 secant squared theta. That looks like we can work with it. Oh, but now we have x and dx and theta, and these don't agree. What do we do? Oh, wait. We have x. It's just the square root. of x squared. 3 secant theta. Okay, all right. So let's rewrite this one more time. 9 secant squared theta minus 9 divided by 3 secant theta dx. All right. And this is where, I'm not going to go to red because, you know, it's Mean Girls Day. But this is where you need to throw up a pink flag. Right? Because if you try to integrate this thing, you're like, oh, I have thetas and it's dx. It's just going to be this times x. No. All right. Theta is related to x. It's a function of x. So we can't just integrate this right now. The number one mistake that students make when trying to do trig subs, trig sub integrals, is forgetting to replace dx with d theta. All right, we can't just take the integral of this with respect to x because theta is related to x. All right, if we could just take the integral of this, then it would just be so easy. And that's not how calculus works. So we need to replace dx with d theta. All right, but we can't just replace dx with d theta because dx is related to d theta in some way. How is it related? Let's figure that out. This is the step that people forget. They don't take the derivative of this equation. Dx is equal to 3 secant theta tangent theta. Oop, not tangent, d. Theta d theta. All right, this is getting real complicated. How could this possibly be better? How could this possibly be making our expression more simple and easier to anti-differentiate? Well, let's take it to the next page. We have the integral square root of 9 secant squared theta minus 9 all over. I believe it was, let me just go back and double check. Yeah, 3 secant theta. And then we had dx, but dx is equal to, what do we have? 3 secant tangent d theta. And I can replace dx. Dx was here. I can replace it with 3 secant theta, tangent theta, d theta. And oh my gosh, here we go. Bam, 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 bam. Those are gone. All right. Okay, cool, cool. All right, cool. Cool, 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 cool. For my community fans out there. Is this getting better? Right? We still haven't used the whole reason why we did this sub. 9 secant squared theta minus 9. Let's factor out a 9 and then take it out of the integral. That's going to be a 3 times secant squared theta minus 1. All right. Okay. Okay. All right. That 3 can come out. Who cares about that 3? Secant squared theta minus 1. That's. Wait a second. Secant squared theta minus 1. That's tangent squared theta. That's tangent squared theta. I'm going to leave the 3 in there because I don't have room for it. Okay. Square root of tangent squared theta. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. I'm going to stay on this page for this final line. 3. The square root of tangent squared. Tan theta tan squared theta d theta. Look at that. And that's easy. We know how to take the integral of tan squared theta. Let's do it. Let's take it to the next page. All right, so I have the integral of 3 tan squared theta d theta. And then, there is an issue here. I can't just anti-differentiate it willy-nilly, right? This is not one of our memorized trig derivatives or integrals. All right, I need to turn this into secant squared theta minus 1. That's correct. Yep. I just imagined that Pythagorean identity in my head. Move that 1 over. Yep. And then I can anti-differentiate this. All right. 3, the antiderivative of secant squared, that's going to be... Oh, and I don't know why I'm rewriting an integral. Let me just go ahead and zoop. That's going to be a tan theta minus theta. Plus C. Don't forget the plus C. Are we done? Psych, we are not done because we set out to anti-differentiate the square root of x squared minus sine over x. Right, this is all in x's. Right? The answer is not tangent theta minus theta times 3 plus c. Right, we need to back sub time. And this is where it gets a little bit tricky still. Right? What is tangent theta and theta in terms of x? Well, we know the relationship between x and theta. I believe it was x is equal to 3 secant theta. Do a little bit of algebra here, and we get secant theta is equal to x divided by 3. Here is the final key to these problems. Draw the following picture. Right, here is theta. Secant of theta is x divided by 3. So that is hypotenuse over adjacent. And I can solve for this third triangle. I just used SOHCAHTOA there. This side is going to be the square root of x squared. Wait a second. This is the numerator in our original problem. Right? That is the essence of this problem. Right? Always draw this picture. This picture is kind of telling us why this trig sub makes sense. We can use secant theta because if I have a triangle with hypotenuse x and an adjacent leg 3, then the opposite side is the hypotenuse. That's the what we're using here. This gives us all the information that we need. Right? What is tangent of theta? That's the square root of x squared minus 9 over 3, opposite over adjacent. What is theta? Theta is whatever you want it to be. It's the arc secant of, what is that going to be? The arc secant of x over 3. It's also the arc tangent of the square root of x squared minus 9 over 3. It's kind of whatever you want it to be. This picture gives you all of the information. 3 times the tangent of theta. Square root of x squared minus 9 all over 3. And then theta, that's the arc secant of hypotenuse over adjacent plus c. Of course, plus c. And we are done with this integral. Let me go ahead and write down the steps that I think you guys should take when you're solving a trig sub problem, getting tricky with it. So the first thing is identify which trig identity is appropriate. Identify which trig identity. Once you've done that, then you want to identify what x and dx are. Once you've written down what x squared is, I'm going to actually add that here, x squared is equal to. That's kind of the essence of identifying the trig identity. What are you setting x squared equal to so that you can get this trig identity? Once you've done that, solve for x and solve for dx. And please don't forget dx because just from experience, that is what people forget. And then once you've done this, do the u sub. You're going to replace a ton of stuff in the integral with a ton of new stuff in terms of theta or whatever variable you choose. Do the u sub, and then at the end, make sure that you draw that triangle and back sub. All right, and drawing that triangle is the key to these problems. Once you've drawn that triangle, it does all the work for you. You can figure out what theta or tangent theta or secant theta or whatever you have at the end that's in terms of theta. That triangle will tell you what it is in terms of x. All right. What is that triangle rooted in? What x is right here in number 2. All right, so here is our next integral. 1 over x times the square root of 25x squared plus 16. Of course, dx. Step 1. Identify which trig identity we're using. Look at this thing. Think about the three forms. Which one was something plus a number? Right, that was secant squared theta is equal to tangent squared theta plus 1. This is the one that we want to use right here. What does that do for us? Right, we want plus 16, but that's the identity that we want. Right, we need to set tangent, we need to set 25x squared equal to tangent squared theta so that, sorry, I want 16. We need to set 25x squared equal to 16 tangent squared so we can do the replacement and get that identity, pull the 16 out. All right, but now we have tangent squared theta plus 1. We're going to have 16 times tangent squared theta plus 1. Divide by 25. We didn't do this step last time. That's one of the little nuances that this one is introducing. All right, get our x. We're now in the stage 2. All right, they're very fluid. We're in stage 2. 4 over 5 tan theta. And then what people forget to do, don't forget to do this, is get your dx as well. Your dx is going to be 4 fifths secant squared theta d theta. Awesome. And if you want to, while you're at it right now, draw that triangle. Step 4. I said you could do it at the end of, these two steps are kind of interchangeable. U sub and draw the triangle for the back sub. Draw the triangle when you want to draw the triangle, when you need it, or early on with that knowledge that you're going to use it later. So we have that x is equal to 4 fifths tan theta. So we have that, just real quick, where do I want to write it? You know what I'm going to do? Move this little dude over. Do it right here. So we're going to get tangent theta is equal to 5 fourths x. All right, so this is going to be a 5 fourths, and this is going to be an x. And you know what I'm going to do? I'm actually going to make 5 5x. 5x over 4. You'll see why in a second. Opposite over adjacent. I don't even know why I write an x there in the first place. All right, because what's this going to be? This is going to be the square root of 25x squared plus 16. That's what's right here. All right, so we did this early on. That's okay. You can do it at the beginning. You can do it at the end, whenever works for you. But this triangle here is going to be invaluable at the end. All right, let's do the step 3, and then we'll do step 4, the back sub part. All right, we already did the first part of step 4. All right, U sub time. 1 over, what is x? 4 fifths tangent theta. Wait, we have, I'll save it for the next step, the simplification, but we've set ourselves up, so we have 16 tan squared theta plus 16. Awesome. And then don't forget to replace your dx with 4 fifths. That's going to cancel out with this 4 fifths. That's nice. Secant squared theta d theta. Awesome. Let's go ahead and do what we set out to do. Get rid of this square root. All right, while we're at it, boom, boom, 4 fifths go away. Tangent theta, secant squared theta, d theta. And then what is this going to be? A 16 tan squared theta plus 16. Take out the 4. And then we're left with tangent squared plus 1, which is secant squared theta. Square root of that is secant theta. Wonderful. And then boom, boom. Secants are gone. And then what do we have here? We have secant theta over 4 tan theta. I don't know why I brought that 4 back in. Let's take that 4 back out. D theta. That looks way more doable. All right, this page is getting a little bit crowded. Let's take it to the next page. Right, I'm going to bring that triangle over as well. We had 5x, we had 4, and we had 25 x squared minus, plus 16 square rooted. Right, that's theta. Right, that's going to be invaluable in just a moment. But let's keep going. 1 fourth, I'm going to turn these into sines and cosines because I think that's going to be useful. Cosine theta. This is going to be, ooh, that's a cotangent in the numerator. So that's going to be cosine theta over sine theta d theta. Up bam, up bam. 1 over sine. That's going to be a cosecant theta. And look at that. Ideally, you know exactly what this thing is. 1/4 negative ln absolute value cosecant theta plus cotan theta plus c. You know how to do this. We prereqed it at the beginning this with secant, but you should know exactly how to do this integral. If you've forgotten, multiply by cosecant theta plus cotan theta over cosecant theta plus cotan theta, and just knock it out. Do it yourself. Right, but there is almost your answer. Almost your answer. What is cosecant theta? Here is your answer. What's the what's cosecant theta? Well, let's just refer to our triangle right here. And the cosecant of theta is hypotenuse. So we got negative ln. We got the hypotenuse, square root of 25x squared plus 16 over opposite 5x. And then cotangent, that's going to be adjacent over opposite. And then I almost ran out of room. That is not the answer. Plus C. Alrighty, I got one last one for you to make this just a little bit more tricky. Sorry. That pun was maybe intended. All right, this one is tricky. Tricky. What do we do? Go ahead and attempt it. I'm going to do this one in 3, 2, 1. Step 1. Figure out which trig identity to use. It's not obvious, but you learned 2 years ago in pre-calc that there is a clever way to factor this thing. Wouldn't it be great if this was a perfect square trinomial and I could turn this into the difference of squares? We did this in pre-calculus 2 years ago. And I believe I'm going to want a 4 and then of this. Let me look at my notes real quick. I have a copy error. This needs to be actually a 3. Let me go back and fix that on the first page. All right, I went back and I fixed that on the first page, but I will say this at the beginning. All right, so at the beginning will be fixed now, the beginning of the video. This should be a 3 because now I have minus x minus 1 quantity squared. Right. I'm gonna break this into more steps. Minus x squared, minus 2x, minus 1. That's what I wanted. That's why I need this to be a 3 for the example. Sorry about that copy error. Sorry if you looked at this and had no idea where to go. Now we're in business. Minus x minus 1. Squared. Actually, x plus 1 squared. Cool. Dx, dx. All right, which identity is it going to be? We got a number minus an expression. That is going to be cosine squared theta is equal to 1 minus sine squared theta. Awesome. 1 minus an expression. This is the identity that I care about. I want to set x plus 1 squared equal to 4 sine squared theta. So then I'm going to have 4 minus 4 sine squared theta. I can take out that 4. I'm going to have 1 minus sine squared theta. It's going to become a cosine squared. Then it's going to get square rooted. Wonderful. All right, while I'm at it, I'm going to solve for x. It's a little bit different. Now we have that minus 1. That's going to affect things as we move forward. All right, dx is going to be 2 cosine theta d theta. Cool. Everything I need to do this u sub. All right, I'm going to get that picture while I'm at it, though. Add one, or actually this is what I want to solve right here. All right, divide by 2. Sine theta is equal to x plus 1 divided by 2. Opposite over hypotenuse. All right, this is going to be the square root of 4 minus x plus 1 squared. Wonderful. This is exactly the triangle that I want. Let's go ahead and do this u sub. The integral of x squared over the square root of 4 minus x plus 1 squared dx. Let's just figure out what everything is. All right, x squared is x quantity squared. And we established that x is 2 sine theta minus 1. So that is going to be squared. We have 4 minus x plus 1 squared. X plus 1 squared was 4 sine squared. So we have a 2 times the square root of 1 minus sine squared. That's going to disappear soon enough. And then dx was 2 cosine theta d theta. All right, 1 minus sine squared theta, that's cosine squared theta. Square root is cosine, so these are going to cancel out. The 2s are going to cancel out. A bang, 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 bang. And then we're left with 2 sine theta minus 1 squared d theta. Nice. Let's keep going. So I know from doing lots and lots of polar problems how to do this integral. It's going to be 4 sine squared theta minus... It's going to be a 4 sine theta plus 1 d theta. And then let's see, this sine squared, we can't deal with that. We need to do 1 minus cosine 2 theta divided by 2. So we're going to get 2 times 1 minus cosine 2 theta. That's a little annoying. And then we're going to have minus 4 sine theta, that's a little bit more manageable, plus 1, very manageable. Just keep going with this thing. We're going to get a 2 and a 1, that's going to be a total of 3. We're going to get a and minus 4 sine theta, and then minus cosine 2 theta. I don't know why I wrote it that way, that's just the way I wrote it. I think I dropped something. I think 2 times negative cosine 2 theta is negative 2 cosine 2 theta. Sorry about that. All right, we're going to get 3 theta minus, actually plus, 4 cosine theta. Awesome. I think it's going to be plus, no, it's going to be a minus, that's a cosine, minus sine 2 theta plus c. Let me just double check. The derivative of 3 theta is 3. The derivative of 4 cosine theta is negative 4 sine theta. Awesome. And then sine 2 theta, it's going to become a cosine 2 theta, but then the 2 theta is going to bring a 2 out in the front. Wonderful. This is correct. But we got thetas, and we need to turn them back into x's. So we're really close to the end. All right, I'm going to take it to the next page, and I'm going to rewrite this. I'm going to redraw my triangle so I can get this back sub going, and we're going to finish this problem. I have 3 theta, let me make sure I don't make any copy errors, plus 4 cosine theta, minus sine 2 theta, of course plus c. Alright, here's my triangle, not very well drawn, but that is okay. Let me go ahead and go back 2 pages, remind myself what it looks like. Alright, this is all just for me, not for you guys, sorry if it's a little bit confusing, the back and forth. All right, this is going to be 4 minus x plus 1 quantity squared. All right, There's my triangle. Let's do this thing. All right, what's theta? All right, theta is arc whatever trig function you want with whatever sides work with it. So I'm going to do arc sine. I like writing these two. I don't want to write that big square root. So arc sine opposite over hypotenuse. Cool. All right, cosine theta is adjacent over hypotenuse, which is going to be a 2. Oh, look at that. That's going to cancel with the 4. I'll write it then on the next line. Minus x plus 1 squared. And then sine 2 theta. Uh-oh. I don't have 2 theta. I have theta. 2 theta would be like up here. I don't know what that triangle is going to be. All right, let me just like delete what I just drew there because it's kind of confusing. I don't know what 2 theta is. Oh, wait. Yes, I do. Sine 2 theta is sine, cosine, cosine, sine, cosine, cosine, sine, sine, sine. It is 2 sine theta cosine theta plus C. Kind of running out of room here. Sorry about that. All right, we're going to get the next line. We're going to sub back sub on the next line for that one. 3. Arc sine x plus 1 over 2 plus 4 times 2, that's going to be 4 divided by 2, that's going to be 2. 4 minus x plus 1 squared minus 2 times sine theta is x plus 1 over 2. Oh, and that's going to cancel. Those 2s are going to cancel out. I'll write one more line with the final nice, neat answer. Cosine theta is the square root of 4 minus x plus 1 squared all over 2. All right, so this 2 is going to cancel with that. I'm going to be left with the 2 in the denominator. Final answer, 3 arc sine x plus 1 divided by 2 plus 2 4 minus x plus 1 quantity squared minus divided by 2 x plus 1 times the square root of 4 minus x plus 1 squared plus C. I've got that there too. There is your final answer to this obnoxiously difficult integral. Let me throw some parentheses around this x plus 1, and we are fini. All right, this can be difficult, but when I really mean when I say, let me go back here to this slide right here. These steps are invaluable. I absolutely recommend doing them. Let me jump back to the first slide. Here we are. All right. We got tricky with it. We reminded ourselves of the Pythagorean identities, and we identified the three forms of the many different forms that we care about for trig sub integrals. We redid the secant integral just as a real quick aside so that you can use it because it will pop up. It popped up in our second example today. Cosecant it did. But remember that those basic integrals, they are the expectation is that you know them. So review them. They're on the front page of the textbook. And then we did three examples. We did this first one. The second one introduced some new ideas. And the third one introduced a perfect square trinomial. A forced perfect square trinomial turned into difference of squares that we were then able to use the trig sub strategy to solve. These integrals are not easy. Right? The first one is already like at the height of BC calculus's difficulty. Right? We take it one step further by doing these ridiculous ones. Right? But it is definitely not something that you cannot handle. Right? Mr. Shorts and I believe in you. This stuff is difficult, but it is absolutely in your wheelhouse. And with that thought, I think I'm going to close it out here. Have an awesome week. Have an awesome month. Have an awesome semester. See you next time.